Well, good morning once again, and good to be back together. Great time last night and now this morning, and loved what CB had to share today. That was so rich and thankful. You know, I've often said this. I pastor a church that is a large church, and I always say this. I'm not a fan of large churches. I'm not a fan of large churches. I mean, nothing wrong with a large church, but I don't see anything that's so special about a large church necessarily. In fact, if you think about it, imagine that I were to come here back next year. And I come in, obviously the same height, but let's say I've gained 200 pounds. Now, I don't think a lot of people would immediately see me having gained 200 pounds and go, wow, how did he do that? Man, that's fantastic. Look how big he's gotten so quickly. You'd probably look at me and say, I don't know, something may be wrong there. Now, if there's somehow I'd taken some growth hormone and I'd now become maybe, you know, another foot or two taller, and I am putting on that kind of weight, you might say, that's good. That looks healthy. That looks fine. What I'm excited about is health. If a church focuses on health, you're going to be okay. Do you know the same is true in the Christian life? If you focus on being healthy as a Christian, you don't have to worry, what's God going to do through me? How's it going to, it'll take care of itself. So anyway, I love what many of the things. Man, it was so good today. So appreciate that. Both these guys, you got a great team here. I'm going to pick up today where I left off. You should have notes that follow. I'm going to go 5 through 11 today, which means that all of these various points are going to be touched on much briefer, but it doesn't mean they're not equally important. So if you have your notes from your materials, go to number 5. Number 5, highly effective kingdom leaders create and follow a strategic plan for their life, family, and ministry. Strategic plan. You know, plans are good. The Lord says that man plans his way. The Lord directs the steps, which certainly validates the fact that plans are not bad. In fact, plans are very good. As long as we don't hold the plans to ourselves and not let the Lord direct the steps, obviously. But I am amazed how many Christians do not use a plan. And I think, therefore, are not as effective as they could be in the things that we're trying to see God use us to accomplish. I know this, that were I to have a company, let's say I'm a businessman, and you're my friend, and you have a lot of discretionary monies available to you. And these discretionary monies that are available to you are to be invested as you choose. And so I go to you and I say, hey, let me ask you a question. Just curious, would you like to make an investment in my new company? You're going to really like what I'm doing. Would you like to make an investment? And you say, well, tell me a little bit about your company. Oh, our company is going to do really good. We're going to make a lot of money, a lot of profit, a lot of money, a lot of profit. Do you want to invest in our company? Well, can you tell me how are you going to make the money? I mean, I'm a little curious about the company. What are you going to do? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, what we're going to do is we're going to make a lot of things really inexpensively, and we're going to sell them for a lot of money. And that makes a lot of profit, and that's how we make our money. Do you want to make an investment? And you're still shy to do that and say, I don't know. I don't think so. Not yet. You'd finally get around to saying, can I see your what? Business plan. Can I see your business plan? How many church leaders and pastors, I'm going to be speaking, I know that we've got a number of pastors here. From time to time, I'm going to keep just kind of jumping out to say something to the pastors. In our churches, we often hear pastors say, I don't understand why people don't invest their time. Why don't they invest their money? Why don't they invest their energy? Why don't they make investment? And the response is, well, because they don't see a plan. that convinces them that this is a worthy place to invest our money. Oh, we're going to do church. We're going to have church every Sunday, and we're going to do this. And we're gonna, but no. Tell me, how do you impact the kingdom? What are you doing to impact the kingdom? Show me your plan. I remember a man in our church who was heading up a company. He was like number two or three, right on top of probably the fastest growing company in America at that time, the highest yielding stocks in all of America. So he comes to me one day and he says, hey, I'm having 11 vice presidents from all over the country coming in. We're doing some training. And I would love to get them exposed to the gospel, and I'd love for you to come and meet with them, but we're a publicly traded company, and we just can't do that. You know, you can't talk about spiritual things and so forth. And so I just wish we could find a way. I said, oh, that's simple. We could do that. He said, there's a way to do that? I said, sure, give me a shot at it. So I meet with these very sharp. I mean, they're all about late 30s, early 40s. They're go-getters. I mean, wow. And so I sit there and I said, hey, let me ask you a question. You men and women that are in these high roles that you're, you know, working in this company, how important do you, first of all, do you have a business plan? Oh, yeah, we got a business plan. How important is your business plan to what you're doing? Oh, if it weren't for our plan, we couldn't accomplish. I mean, that's the most important thing in the world. I said, really? And they went on and on talking about how important the plan was. And I'll never forget, I stopped and I said, can I ask you a question? How many of you have a life plan? Raise your hand, guys, if you have a life plan. And none of them raised their hand. I said, are you telling me that as important as your business plan is, you just told me how you couldn't function as well, you couldn't be the company you are without the plan you have? Don't you think that you would probably even have a better life if you had a plan? Yeah. Hey, let me ask you guys, how many of you have a family? And 10 of 11 of them had a family. They raised their hands. I said, how many of you have a family plan? And they just looked at me like, what? I said, you don't have a plan? Well, it's important to have a plan. And they had no clue of it. So they said, well, explain. Can you tell me your life plan? I said, I would love to, but I can't do that. They said, why not? Well, you see, every plan has a purpose, and a purpose answers the question, why do you exist? And the answer to that question has to be either theistic or atheistic, and mine happens to be theistic, and that's bringing God into the corporate world, and that's not legal, so I can't do that, so sorry, I just can't do that. One of them said, you can do it if we ask you to do it. And I said, well, that would have to be all of you wanting me to do it. They all said, do it. So I start going through the plan. And the first question, see, to me, a plan has five. You might want to even jot, some of you might be interested in how do you develop a plan. I'll tell you real quickly, I think to make it simple, you just answer five questions. The first question is your purpose. Why do we exist? Why do you exist? And that's where I was able to bring the Lord into it. Before long, I'd given the whole gospel to them. They were so eager. Can we get back together? Can we talk further? Number two, you got to have a vision. Doesn't matter what word you tag to this, but a vision. Vision answers the question, what are you trying to accomplish? And then you go to your mission. A mission is how will you accomplish your vision? Then you go to the issue of your values. What do you value most? What's most important to us? Then you can get to the last question, and that would be your goals. How will you know if you're accomplishing your vision and your mission? And I always say, if people answer those questions for their personal life, they've got a life plan. They answer those questions for their family, they got a family plan. You can answer those questions for your business, you have a business plan. And pastors, you can answer those questions, and you've got a ministry plan. And once you get a good plan that everybody can look and go, wow, that's what you're trying to accomplish. That's how you're going to go about accomplishing. That's what you value to do that. These are the goals that, you know what? I want to make an investment in that. That is really, really important. Let's move to number six in your outline. Number six, highly effective kingdom leaders. See how it says there? Use culturally relevant ministry tools. I think I have it written a little different. Culturally relevant ministry tools. I journaled this thought not too awfully long ago. Listen to this. Most pastor teachers, like myself, teach the saints a good theology of ministry while neglecting to equip the saints to do the work of ministry. And then I concluded, in part, because of an absence of effective tools, especially tools to make and train disciples. You see, there was a time in the Christian life that we know that the church and organizations that were doing the parachurch were so effective with the tools that were used. And tools have kind of dissipated a bit. We don't have great tools. For instance, tools to make disciples. I realize that every country here is different than our country and the freedoms and so forth, but I know that there have to be tools. There just have to be tools. And so I got a call from an agent of a sports figure in America that if you followed American sports at all, you would know the name of this person. Very, very, very famous sports figure. All pro everything, you know. And so he said, he's really in trouble in his life. He needs help. Would you meet with him? And he's be there in Atlanta. Could you meet with him? And I said, well, if he wants to meet with me, does he want to meet with me? Yeah, he'll meet with you. I said, are you sure he wants to meet with me? A preacher, he wants to meet with me? Well, I've told him that I want him to meet with you, and he said he was willing. I said, that's not good enough. He's got to be willing. And he says, well, this guy's not real easy to get. And I said, well, then I'm not meeting with him. He said, well, let me get back to you. So he called me back. He said, hey, he's willing to meet with you. I talked to him, and he's willing to meet with you. I said, are you lying to me? He said, no, he really wants to meet with you. I said, all right, you told me he's willing. So we're going to meet at this private club and so forth. So I show up, and I know who he is, and he's probably been told what I look like, because when I walk in, he's sitting by himself, and he looks up at me, and he just rolls his eyes like, oh, boy, oh, boy. So I walked up, called him by name, and I said, I'm Randy, and I said, you don't want to meet with me, do you? He says, nope, nope. I said, then see you later. I told our mutual friend, I told Tony that if you didn't want to meet, I didn't want to meet with you. He told me you wanted to meet, so I'll see you later. And I turned around, walked off. Whoa, you're here. What do you want to tell me? What is it you got? Imagine that. And I said, well, can I show you a little diagram? It was a tool. It was just a tool, and I just had a little diagram to share. And I got through sharing the diagram, and he says, you wouldn't mind meeting with me for 4 weeks to talk about the Bible? To talk about this Jesus? I said, I'd be happy to do it. We met, thoroughly interested, intrigued, went to the point of even indicating a receiving of Christ, though I never saw the fruit to give me confidence it was genuine. I could tell that story over and over. And how do you make disciples? How do you train disciples? Tools, like, do you have a tool, a piece of literature that you know that, hey, this I can give a non-Christian that asks me, who's interested, if it's legal and appropriate, hey, can I give you this? Would you like to take? Just tools. I would encourage you, look for tools that help you get trained. How do I share my faith effectively? And by the way, in terms of tools to train how to share your faith, always remember this. The way evangelism works the best is you let God do the converting using his tool, the Bible. I love what CB said today about the Bible, sharpening a two-edged sword. Man, I meet with non-Christians and they go, I don't believe the Bible at all. I don't care whether they believe in the Bible, because I'm going to encourage them to meet with me, and if they're willing and interested and they want to investigate, I can kind of use a little tool to get them intrigued to investigate the gospel. And when I get them there, I say, well, all I'm going to do, I'll meet with you on one condition, and that is if you'll read a little bit of the Bible every single day. A little bit every single day. And I'm going to take you to where it's in the Gospel of John. You're going to only read this much, but a little every day until we meet again. Would you pledge to do that? If he does, then I say, man, we got a great opportunity to see this person come to faith. You know why? Because God does the converting using his tool, the Bible. People say, well, I can't talk to somebody without knowing the Bible. If they don't believe the Bible, what can I do? They don't even accept the Bible. I say, why do you care? It'd be like me hating Pastor Chris. Let's say I hate him and I want to kill him. And so I grab him outside the church one night. I throw him down on the ground. I put my hand on his neck my knee on his chest, and I say, Chris, I'm going to kill you right now. I hate you. He says, oh, don't kill me. I got a beautiful wife. I got children. No, 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 no. He's on. I said, no, nothing's stopping me. And I pull out of my jacket, I pull a long, foot-long dagger, and I raise it up, and he sees the dagger, and he goes, oh, thank the Lord. I say, thank the Lord? For what? Oh, Randy, you scared me to death. I said, wait a minute, I scared you to death. I thought you were going to pull out a gun and shoot me, which would kill me. But I don't know if you know this, but I don't believe in knives. I really don't. I don't think they hurt. So you stab me all you want, but hurry, because I got to get home for dinner, okay? Now, if I'm a good murderer, what do I do? Do I say, all right, Chris, I'm coming back with a gun. I'm going to get you tomorrow. No, I go, what? He's dead. I always tell people that I'm training in how to share their faith and how to see people come to faith. I always say this, if you want to make it the way God intended it to be, use the dagger. I tell it, if you can remember one thing, always remember, God does the converting using his tool, the Bible. I've seen more people who say, I don't believe in your Jesus, and I don't like this, and I don't agree with this, and I don't think that I'm a bad person, and I don't think God's the only, Jesus is the only way to God, I don't care. And within weeks, they come to faith in Christ. And if you looked at what I did, you'd go, you didn't do much, did you? I said, no. Let God do the converting using his tool, the Bible. But tools, think about tools. They're very, very, very important, all right? Let me take you to number 7. Highly effective kingdom leaders know and practice the value of 4 things. 1, simplicity. Simplicity. Whatever you're doing, do it simply. You know why? Because of number 2. So you can do it repetitively. Repetition. Simplicity, repetition. You see, if you want to, you're asking the Lord, would you help me get in physical condition, Lord? I want to do everything I can to do the best job to stay physically healthy. And all you come up with this plan that you're going to run for an hour every day, and you're going to go to the gym every day for this much, and you're going to do this every day, and you're going to weigh all your food every day, and you're going to, that's not simple. You're not going to be able to do it day after day after day after day after day. You want to have personal time with the Lord? All kingdom impacting leaders, they spend time with God. But when you put every day, I'm going to read this amount, and it's 100 pages of this, of the Bible, you're going to do this, you're going to memorize this much scripture, you're going to do this, you're going to do this. Every day I'm going to do all this. It's going to make me a great man of God, great woman of God. Let me tell you, you will not do it because you won't repeat it long enough to make an impact. The people that make impact learn to be simple, and they repeat it over and over and over. It's a long, consistent journey of faithfulness. I add a third word to that, and that's modeling. You model. With humility, you model. You don't model to show off. You model so that they can learn how to do it too, and that they can benefit from what you've learned. And then as you model it, it's with the idea of multiplying. You see, I think the church has lost the idea of multiplication. We try to add. Okay, I'll help impact your life. I'll disciple you, and I will impact your life. That's not good. We go to them and say, look, I'll disciple you. I'd like to impact your life so that you can impact somebody else's life, so that those people can impact somebody else's life, and the so that just keeps going forever and ever and ever. You see, the beauty of life on life discipleship is that it's the power of two, I call it. Do you know that if a young person, let's say you're 25, 30, 35 years of age, and you say, you know what I'm going to do every year? I'm going to look at for 2 new people to add to a little group I'm going to meet with. And maybe up to 3 years. So I'll have 6 people at one time. Maybe 2 going out every year, 2 coming in every year. Do you know that if they were to do the same thing in other people's lives, and you gave them simple, repetitive tools that would help them learn how to share their faith, learn how to read the scriptures and spend personal worship, and you began to help, and you began to teach and train and so forth, and they just did it, the same thing you've done with them, they do with 2 other people a year and so forth. Do you know that only 10 years, if that were to happen, that there have been 6,000 people or so that have been involved because of what you did in that short period of time? That is amazing. It's not going to happen. It's going to be like a baseball player. I don't know how much y'all watch baseball, but it's like a 1,000 is your batting average of perfection. No one can do that. If you bat 260, you know, 260, that's pretty good. Well, you just bat 260. Bat 200, and you're still touching literally a few thousand people in a very short period of time. I think one of the great rewards of the Christian who's invested their life in multiplying in the lives of others is what Paul says in 1 Timothy, "For who is our joy and our crown of exaltation? Is it not even you in the presence of the Lord?" Imagine being in the presence of the Lord the day you enter into glory, and you get to see a host of people that you've never ever met, but because you very simply repeated something till you got effective enough that you could model it to someone else, who in turn did it with somebody else. And now here you have a host in the heavenlies who are there because of the investment you made in a very, very few people. I've said this on many occasions, and I say it with integrity. I pastor a large church. We have international ministries. We have a lot of things going on, blessing a lot of folks. But I'll tell you, if the elders of our church were to say to me, "Randy, you have to make a choice. You either give up your small little group of disciples that you work with every week, you give them up, or you give up being the pastor of Perimeter Church," and it would not take me 1 second to make the choice. And I'd say, give me my group. Because I can invest in a few that'll invest in a few that'll invest in a few. And Lord willing, oh my goodness, how many people and their spouses and their children and their work partners that they've led to, who knows how many people could be impacted. So remember those four words: simplicity, repetition, modeling, and multiplication. Number 8, highly effective kingdom leaders choose health over size and influence over success. I've already said a word about the church, health over size. Influence over success. I'd put it this way: never compromise spiritual nutrition for the sake of growth. You always want to stay healthy, as I mentioned earlier. There's a book that a good friend of mine has written, a fellow named Robert Lewis. It's called The Church of Irresistible Influence. And for you pastors and church leaders, let me say, what a great analogy he uses. He talks about, you buy a new piece of property and your home is on a coastline. It's right on the edge of the water, of the ocean, and you've got a neighbor who's next door. And you go there and you step there and you leave, "Oh, neighbor, how you doing?" And you look out and you say, "Hey, neighbor, tell me something. When you bought the house, I noticed there's that little island out there, and there's a little building on it. What is that building?" The neighbor says, "I'm not really sure. Nobody really knows for sure, but we assume it's a church because it's on Sunday morning, about the time that a lot of people go to church. There are a few little boats that putter out there, and it comes back on, you know, right after lunch, noontime. We assume it's a church." He said, "There's your isolated church." Scenario number 2: "Hey, neighbor, what is that huge building out there? That huge building. And what is that?" "Oh, that's First Church of the Island." "Oh my, wait till Sunday. You're not going to believe this. It's the place to be. The best communicators, oh, they're such attractive community. Their best music, it's so entertaining. It's so incredible. People love it. In fact, on Sunday morning, you're going to see thousands of boats going out there. And then afterwards, thousands of boats coming back." Man, that's, you know, I don't go to church, but they say if you go to church, that's where you want to go. You'll enjoy it. It's more fun than you can imagine. He said, "There's your church of success." Third scenario: "Hey, neighbor, what's that building out there on that island? Oh, hey, what about that huge bridge, bridging that little island to the mainland? What's that all about?" "You won't be in this community," the neighbor says. "You won't be in this community very long before you'll know. You see that bridge? You know who built the bridge? The church members. That's a church out there. The church members built the bridge. You see all the cars just flooding that bridge, going back and forth right now? You know what they're doing? All week long, they're going and getting resources. And they're bringing those resources to bear upon our community. And everybody knows in our community, if something happens to that church, we're in big, big trouble on the mainland. He says, there's your church of influence. I've talked to Pastor Chris and his wife, and we've talked and heard the different things. Oh, my goodness. I'm so thankful for a church like this one that's not just saying, come to church. Let's just come get it. Let's see how big we can get. What's our number going to be on Sunday? But they're saying, how do we equip and train the people of faith to go out and touch a community and to give the people who are under-resourced what they need, to take care of the people who need advocacy, to deal with the people who are hurting, people that may never come to this church, that's okay. We want to impact the community for the sake of Christ. So good when that's the focus. Number 9, highly effective kingdom leaders embrace the ideal of what I'm going to call 3-strand ministries. There was a pastor who came to called me and said, would you meet with me? I'd like to have lunch with you. So I said, sure. This was assistant pastor of maybe the largest church, evangelical church, in our part of Atlanta for sure. And so I sat down with him. And he said, can you tell me what is it that's different about Perimeter Church? The pastors around here and I, we all talk and we say there's something about Perimeter. What is it? What's the difference? I don't know. That's a great question. But if I were to have to speculate, this is maybe how I would answer it. I asked him, I said, do you know who is noted in all of America as the greatest pastor of all time, ever, ever, ever? I can go to a conference anywhere, and I can say, who do you think the greatest pastor in the history of America is? And one name comes back. You probably wouldn't know it because it's our country, not yours. But you probably know the name if you studied much religious history. His name is Jonathan Edwards. Jonathan Edwards. And I said, I think maybe Jonathan Edwards may be the answer to what you're talking about. Because you see, Jonathan Edwards, the reason he's noted was not because how huge his church was. It was not how popular he was or how entertaining he was. It wasn't any of that stuff. You know what it was? It was the fact that he had a church that was a church of the head, the heart, and the hand. And I explain. The head, good, rich, deep, historical, biblical theology. The heart, passion for reaching people for Christ, a passion to worship and to give yourself in worship to God. But also, thirdly, hands of mercy and justice. When you see a church that's like that, you know, in the history of our country, you know what happened? There used to be some semblance of combination of that. But then in the 1920s in America, the liberal church began to say, you know, we don't believe the Bible's the authority of God. We don't believe it's really His Word inspired without error. And so they pushed away what's called the gospel, and when the gospel's gone, what do you have? Virtually nothing. And so they started heading out to take care of the physical needs of people because they weren't looking for spiritual things now. They took care, and so the rest of the evangelical church said, well, we don't do that. We don't do hands. We do head and heart. And then over time, particularly in the last 20, 30 years, there's been a split between the churches of the head and heart. And now some churches are saying, you know, in order to be faithful, to be good, to reach as many people as possible, we better lower our standards of what we're going to teach, and that is, what does everyone agree in? If they don't agree with creation, then let's not teach creation. Oh, if they don't really believe in, you name the subject, and you do believe in it, well, we can't teach it because that may run people off. And all of a sudden, it got to where it was just a soft pablum of type of teaching that's going to be offered. It's just nothing. And that's why I love what I heard what CB was saying. It's the same thing. It's just like, wow. Same thing in America as in India. It's like, it's just like there's no depth of truth. See, one of the things I don't enjoy as much about doing this, I love teaching the Word of God. I'm going to do that Sunday. My 12th principle is going to be able to just get in the Scriptures and look. But I'm telling you, that's what happens in church, though. There's just very little of that, and the Word of God doesn't mean much. Then what happened is there were those churches that said, we're going to be faithful to the historical, biblical teaching of Scripture, and we're going to teach it well. But you walk in that church and you go, man, the stench of death is all around us. It's dead. It's boring. There's nobody coming to faith. There's no worship taking place. This is like, what's going on? And now people are having to make choices. Am I going to go to a church of the head? Am I going to a church of the heart? Am I going to go to a church of the hand? Those have to come together. And I say all that for each of us as the leaders, kingdom leaders. It's the same in a personal life. If you don't have a deep, rich, historical, biblical theology that you're building on regularly in your study of God's Word, and you don't have a fervor for the things of God to reach lost people and to worship Him, going to corporate worship daily and personal or weekly and personal worship daily, and if you're not really looking to the hurting people around you and saying, I need to invest my time and energy to hurting people, to the degree that we're three strand, that's when we become highly effective kingdom leaders. Let me move to number 10. Highly effective kingdom leaders emphasize the marriage of grace and truth and duty. I'm sorry, grace and duty. I don't know about here, but the young people of our country have come out of a very desperate generation because of a lack of really sensing love from the family, from the parents as they need. Not everywhere, obviously, but there's a lot of insecurity. And the people that are now coming up in the church as young people, they're having this issue of, well, you know what, I don't like duty. I don't think we should be talking about duty. And there are other people that are kind of swinging the pendulum the other way until you've got like two extremes of people. Some that are always talking about what you have to do for God to love you and you better do this. And these people become legalists. And then on the other hand, you have people that are antinomian, antinomous, nomos is law, against the law, that, hey, there's no rules now. God loves you, it doesn't matter what you do, just do what you want to do, and God loves you anyway, and so you just live over here. Well, the truth of it is, I don't see in the church true legalists who really believe if I am very, very, very good, God will love me, period. They understand enough of the gospel. And there are not really any people that are real Christians that I'm watching that are over here as antinomians that really say, it doesn't matter what you do, you can do anything, God doesn't care. But if you listen to them very long, you would assume they really are in those extremes. They're kind of quasi-legalists or quasi-antinomians. Let me tell you how it should work. The Christian walk is a walk. I like to think of it as two steps. You have a right foot that starts, and it's followed by a left foot. Nobody with two legs who walks normal walks right foot, right foot, right foot, right foot. Nobody walks normal, left foot, left foot, left foot, left foot. But if you listen to some preachers, it's as if the right foot is going to be your grace. You always start with grace, what God does for us. But the response, what happens in the heart for somebody that experiences grace, is duty follows. It's the right, it's just a normal thing. Sure, I love the one who has redeemed me. And his grace is so marvelous. How can you be loved like that without loving him and wanting to do what he commands? And it follows. And so it's a grace and duty and grace and duty. And that's the Christian walk. But there's some people that are over here that if you listen to them, they believe there's both. But what you're really seeing them do is this. They're talking about right foot grace. It's grace, 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 whoops, duty. Grace, grace, and you listen to them and it's all about grace, grace, grace. All you hear is grace, 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 gospel, gospel, grace, grace, gospel, gospel, grace, 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 gospel. And you don't hear anything about obeying. I had a young person write me in our church and said, I'm so tired of you talking about duty. I don't ever need to hear about duty. Oh, I know you talk about grace a lot, probably in the same amount, but I am one that needs only grace. I do not need to hear about any duty. Do you know how much of God's word you got to take away if you say, well, we can't address anything with duty? He said, that's just what I want, not what he needs. There are those people over here that are on the other side, and it's just duty, 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 and then it's grace. Duty, 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 grace. No, it's grace and duty, grace and duty. That's the Christian walk. I think the bigger issue and reason why that's become a problem is not so much theological reasons, though it is a theological issue, no doubt. But I think what lays beneath it are more psychological and sociological issues. It's people craving unconditional love. They didn't see it from their families. They felt like they had to earn the approval of their parents, the approval of their boss, the approval of their teacher, the approval of their coach, all about performance, performance, performance. And now they're just saying, I crave to not have to have duty to be loved. And the truth of it is, you don't have to have duty to be loved. You have duty because you're loved. I think they're just simply missing that whole idea. It's not duty, it's not a condition of acceptance, it's a fruit of acceptance. My last point, number 11. Number 11, highly effective kingdom leaders embrace the authentic gospel. The authentic gospel. I want to suggest to you that if I ask you, do you believe the gospel, that every person here would, relatively speaking, know what I mean by gospel. What does gospel mean, by the way? What's the word mean? Good news? Yeah, good news. Do you know that the gospel, if you really want to know what the gospel is, it's not just that Jesus died for our sins. It is that. But it's far more than that. The gospel has to do with everything from the birth, the life, the death, the resurrection, the ascension, and the reign of Christ for all eternity. That really is the gospel. It's much bigger than we understand. But if you want to take it to its simplest understanding, just to kind of get a good understanding, I think that maybe we could talk about the gospel in this way. I like to put it in a threefold statement. Listen to this. You might find this to be helpful in using it as a little tool with other people. What is the gospel? The gospel is, number one, that we lost it all. We lost it all. We, humanity, lost our perfection and we lost our goodness. Would you agree with that? We lost it all. Number two statement is he, Jesus, he did it all. I mean, didn't he do it all? Did he do everything we need for our salvation? Everything? Absolutely. So he did it all. The third statement of the gospel is that we, his followers, we get it all. We get it all. We get his whole righteousness imparted to us. We're viewed as righteous as Christ himself. That's the good news right there. And by the way, there's no good news without bad news. The bad news started it off. We lost it all. Well, if I ask you now, how many of you people believe those three aspects of the gospel? I bet every hand would go up. Probably every hand. Now, I don't know you personally, but I know the Christian community pretty well. At least I know it in our own country. And I know this, that there would be vast, 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 probably majority of the people who would raise their hand, that once they began to really look at it, they'd have to admit, I probably don't agree with that gospel. What I really hold to is a distorted version of that gospel. And I want you to understand the great, great consequences of not embracing the fullness of the authentic gospel. See, here's what a lot of people who really do love Jesus, they know him, but here's what they really believe. They don't believe that we lost it all. They believe that we lost a lot. They lost a lot. Oh, we lost our perfection, yes. And we lost a lot of goodness, but there's a little good left in all of us, right? Isn't that right? Well, no, not if we lost it all. It probably accounts for what I was mentioning just the other day. It probably accounts for why Jesus would come along saying, there's none good, no, not one. That's in Romans. Paul quotes that. But Jesus came along and says, why do you call me good? Do you know that there's none good but one? Again, he's not saying he's not good. He's just saying, hey, you need to understand this, that you don't think I'm God. Why would you call me good? Because there's only one that's good, and that's God. David, there's none good, no, not one. That's what he said in the psalm. Paul quotes him in Romans, and he says, hey, there's none good, no, not one. There's none that seek for God, good, no, not one. Well, why is that? Because we lost it all. There's not even any goodness. But see, if we ask the typical crowd, what happens to a little child who is of such and such an age, and they're like 12 or 13, and they're another faith, not even Christian faith, and they call out to their God every day. And what happens to that person when they're tragically killed in a car wreck when they're 11 years of age? And many a Christian who's well schooled in the Bible goes, well, you know, I guess the Bible does say that, you know, I guess when you really think about it, I guess, Randy, help me out. I've always been concerned. How do you answer that question? Do you know why that's a hard question to answer? Because we still hold on to that idea that there's a little good in all of us. Do you know to the degree that we can come to the place and root that belief out, to that degree our faith becomes strong? So it leads to another problem. If you believe that we lost a lot, do you know by necessity we have to believe that he only did a lot? Oh, he went to the cross, and boy, did he do a lot. He went to the cross. You know what? I didn't do very much. All I did was take a little goodness that was left in me. Remember, there's a little good in all of us, they would say. And I create a little of my own faith, a little of my own repentance, and I bring that as my offering, and he brings his offering of the cross, and he does a lot. I don't do that much. Here's the great, great danger. If we believe that we lost only a lot, we have to believe that only he did a lot. By necessity, we will conclude that we only get a lot. Oh, we get forgiven? Yes. We go to heaven? Yes. We get a lot of good stuff. But we don't get it all. And that's the person who can't embrace the fullness that we have the righteousness of Christ. And when you understand you have the righteousness of Christ, there is a freedom and joy in life that no other person can experience to the same degree. You see, it's because we believe that we only get a lot that so many of us probably here today are caught in a performance trap. And we don't have our time with God on a regular basis. And all of a sudden we think, uh-oh, God's looking at me he's mad at me and he doesn't like me anymore and he doesn't accept me the way he used to accept me. That's not true. That's not true. He grieves over our sin. He hates when we don't obey because he loves us so much and his standard is so perfect. Yes. But acceptance? No. It's not altered at all because he sees us as righteous as his son. Let me tell you, folks, when we get that, now we've got the ticket to becoming this highly effective Christian leader. Study the Word of God. Know the historical, biblical depth of God's Word. Understand the ways of God. I close with this. I used the story already here in one of the groups, didn't I, about the golf pro. I used that, didn't I? Did I use that? Did I mention about the golf pro? A speech maker, I can't remember. All right, I close with this. And by the way, if you've heard me already say this, just pretend like you hadn't. Make me feel good, okay? But I'll reemphasize if I did say it in a seminar or wherever. This guy comes to me, calls me, and says, can you meet with me? I need some help. Who are you? Tells me his name. He's a noted golf pro. Great golf pro. Wonderful golf player. And I go, I'll meet with you. And he says, what can I do for you? He says, well, we need to talk. So we get together, we're having lunch. I said, what is the deal? He said, well, I just want you to know this. I just want you to know that I'm a really good person. However, I've got some struggles. I said, well, what are your struggles? Well, I'm an alcoholic. I'm drinking so much, I'm gonna lose my career and my family, and I can't quit drinking. But now, don't get me wrong, I'm a good person. Okay. Next thing he says, and besides that, he said, again, I don't want you to get me wrong, I'm a good person, but I'm having an affair with a woman right now that I've got a wonderful wife and family, but oh, she's got me in her claws. I just can't give up. I can't give her up. I'm trying hard, but I can't. But don't get me wrong, I'm a good person. I said, okay. And he said, and besides that, and he goes on to tell me these things he's doing, and he says, but I'm a good person, I'm a good person. Finally, I stopped. I said, let me ask you this question. I know that, by the way, I know that golf is not a big sport here, but I think you'll understand the analogy. I asked him, I said, is it true that if you have the perfect grip, the way you hold the golf club, and you have a perfect posture, the way you're lined up, your back and your posture is perfect, and you have your alignment perfect, exactly where it should be, and you know nothing else about golf, and you start practicing real hard a lot, is it true you will become a good golfer in time? Pretty good golfer. He said, absolutely. Is the reverse true? You take away, have a bad grip, bad posture, bad alignment, and you practice all you want to practice, you'll never become a great golfer. True or false? He said, that's true. I said, do you know the same is true in life? That we have a grip, posture, and alignment? And the same is true. If you get a good grip, posture, and alignment, man, you're going to go on strong in your faith. If you got a bad grip, posture, and alignment, you're going to try, and you'll never get very good. I said, you know what your grip is? It's your view of yourself. You know what your posture is? It's your view of God. You know what your alignment is? It's your view of the world and life in which we live. I said, can I give you a diagnostic? Just like you could look at my grip and say, whoops, you got a bad grip. I don't know if you're perfect, but you probably know more than me because you're a golf pro. Well, I'm kind of a Christian pro. I'm a pastor. And I can probably look and give you a little bit better idea than you would have. Do you want me to look at your grip, posture, and alignment? He says, yeah. So I gave him four different things about God, about man, to start with. I said, man is good. Number two, man is good with a little bad. Number three, man is bad with a little good. Number four, man is bad. Which is he? And he said, what everybody else says, he's good with a little bad. I said, well, you got a terrible grip. I can tell you now, your grip's bad. I did the same thing with God, gave him four alternatives, picked the wrong one. Same thing I did with world and life. He picked the wrong one, biblically speaking. I said, do you understand that you have a bad grip, posture, and alignment? And you're coming to me saying, I'm trying so hard. I'm practicing to be good, and I can't get good. I said, you're right, because you got to clean up those three things. That's why when we disciple, we try to give them a curriculum that is just chock full with your view of yourself, your view of God, and your view of the world and life. That's what causes people to become strong in the faith. It's not just meeting with people. It's not just trying hard to help them get better. It's giving them the skills and the tools they need. That's discipleship. Sunday, I'll close with a number 12 that I preach here. It'll be highly effective kingdom leaders routinely appropriate God's power. And we'll talk out of the book of Romans for that. So let me pray, and let's close out our time. Father in heaven, grateful for this time here. Pray that you would again take us to become the highly effective kingdom leaders that you want us to be and we desire to become. We thank you for this. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.